Bea here, and welcome back to biology. Have you ever rolled dice? How many possible outcomes are there? You probably just thought in your head, six. What is the chance of rolling a four? If you said one in six, you're right. These are questions of probability, and it turns out that we use probability to determine outcomes in genetics too. Reginald Punnett, who was one of the first English geneticists, developed a tool in the early 1900s called the Punnett Square, so that he could connect his genetics research with what he knew of probability and statistics. Before we try our hand at filling out a Punnett Square, let's review some important things we already know. Each parent has two alleles for every gene, but will only be able to pass on one of those two alleles to each offspring they may have. You might remember this example from way back in Unit 1, looking at the alleles you inherit for red hair. We'll be looking at traits in pea plants today, but the same rules apply. For now, we'll number the alleles 1 and 2. The offspring could get allele 1 from dad and allele 1 from mom, or allele 1 from dad and allele 2 from mom. They could also get allele 2 from dad and allele 1 from mom, or allele 2 from dad and allele 2 from mom. So there are four total combinations of alleles that an offspring could get. A Punnett square will help us predict those four combinations and determine the probability of each combination happening. Before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to predict genotypes and phenotypes by constructing Punnett squares, and use Punnett squares to show that two traits are inherited independently. A Punnett square is a visual representation of what genotypes the offspring of two parents could possibly have. The first thing to consider when setting up a Punnett square is the genotypes of the two parents. These will be placed at the top and the left of the square. It doesn't matter which parent goes on top or on the left, the results will always turn out the same either way. In the example we're going to try first, we will predict the outcome when two heterozygous organisms are crossed. So the genotype of both parents is big A, little a. Note that both parents here would show the dominant phenotype, though they do both carry a recessive allele that could be passed on to their offspring. Let's see what happens. We place the parental genotypes at the top and left of the table, one letter per row or column. Next, we fill in the boxes of the table to represent possible allele combinations for the offspring. To do this, simply look up and look left. You'll see a letter in each place. Copy it into the box. For our first box, we have big A at the top and big A at the left. So this box is big A, big A. We do the same for the other boxes and get big A, little a, then another big A, little a, and finally, little a, little a. Remember that for heterozygous genotypes like big A, little a, it is conventional to always list the big letter first, regardless of which parent it came from. We can use the results of this table to calculate genotype and phenotype ratios. This tells us the probability of having offspring with these possible allele combinations and traits. Remember that phenotype refers to the physical trait expressed by the organism, while the genotype is the two-letter allele combination, with the dominant allele always being represented with a capital letter. From our results, we see that one out of the four boxes is labeled big A, big A. Two of the four boxes are big A, little a, and one out of four is little a, little a. We could keep these as fractions or change to percentages, which would give us 25% big A, big A, 50% big A, little a, and 25% little a, little a. For the phenotype ratios, both the big A, big A genotype and the heterozygous genotype, big A, little a, will show the dominant phenotype. So 75% will have the dominant trait, and 25% will have the recessive trait. These percentages can be applied to as many offspring as the plant has. The four boxes of the Punnett square are simply used to calculate these percentages and do not indicate that the plant can only have four offspring. It could have hundreds over the course of its life. The 25% or 1/4 recessive phenotype that we have found may sound familiar. Last time, when we looked at the results of Mendel's pea plant experiment, we found that 25% of the F2 generation always had the recessive trait, even though neither of the parents had the recessive trait. Anytime two heterozygous parents are crossed, they will produce an organism with the recessive trait about 1/4 of the time, because there is a 25% chance that both parents will give the offspring a recessive allele. Let's run through another example of a Punnett square to make sure you've got the hang of it. This time, we'll cross two of Mendel's pea plants, both tall, which is the dominant trait over short. One tall parent is homozygous, big T, big T. The other has the heterozygous genotype, big T, little t. To make the Punnett square, we'll put the two parents, big T, and big T, little t, at the top and left. Our strategy to fill in boxes is simple. Look up and look left. So we get big T, another big T, then big T, little t, and another big T, little t. Can you figure out what the genotype ratio is? We have two big T, big T's and two big T, little t's. When the numbers are equal like this, we'll often say it's a 1-to-1 ratio. What about the phenotype ratio? Well, they all have at least one big T, so they're all tall. For our next example, we're going to be detectives and work backwards to solve a mystery. We've got another set of Mendel's pea plants, and this time we're looking at the flower color. Purple is known to be dominant, while white is recessive. A purple and white plant were crossed, and the offspring had the following traits. 26 were purple, and 24 were white. This gives us an approximately 50-50 split for purple and white in the offspring group. Our mystery to solve. What were the genotypes of the parents? Do we have enough information to figure this out? Let's set up a Punnett square and fill in what we know. The white-flowered parent had to have the genotype little p, because that's the only way to show the recessive trait. The purple-flowered parent could have been big P, or big P, little p. We'll have to use the results of the offspring ratios to decide which it is. We know that the white-flowered parent would have given all of the offspring a little p, so we can go ahead and put one in each box. We also know that about half of our offspring were purple, so two of the four boxes must also have a big P. The other two were white, so they were little p. What parental genotype on the left would have given us these results? The purple-flowered parent must have been heterozygous. Big P, little p. After all, had the purple parent been a big P, all offspring would have gotten a big P and been purple. Mystery solved! Sometimes we want to make a Punnett square that shows the inheritance of two traits together. In fact, this is how Mendel showed that the traits he studied in pea plants were inherited independently from one another. But to do this, we're going to need a bigger Punnett square. Think much bigger! This is called a two-factor Punnett square. To see how it works, we'll look at an example of Mendel's pea plants with seeds that are either round or wrinkled and yellow or green. Let's see what we could predict from a cross between a seed which was heterozygous for both round and yellow, and a seed which was wrinkled and heterozygous yellow. The most challenging part of a two-factor Punnett square is determining the possible gametes of the parents. Because we are looking at two traits, there are four possible combinations from each parent. our round yellow parent could have the gametes big R, big Y, big R, little y, little r, big Y, or little r, little y. Our wrinkled yellow parent could have produced little r, big Y, little r, little y, and another little r, big Y, and little r, little y. Even though the last two combinations are duplicates, it's important to list them on the table to get the right results. If following this step was challenging, there's more practice and examples in the lesson PDF, so be sure to check it out. Filling in the table works just like before. Look up and look left and copy down what you see. We won't go through all 16 individual boxes, but here are the results you would get. We always pair up the two versions of R and then the two versions of Y, and big letters come before small letters. But filling in the table is not the most important task here. What we really want to know is whether the results we get from the Punnett square will match the results we get from a real-life test. To find percentages that we can compare, we need to count the number of each phenotype that was present in the table. These will be our expected results. We'll start with the dominant traits, round and yellow. There were 6 boxes, out of 16 that were round and yellow. There were also 6 out of 16 boxes that were wrinkled and yellow. Then 2 boxes out of 16 that were round and green, and 2 boxes that were wrinkled and green. We divide our fractions to make percentages. These percentages represent what we would expect to see in any set of offspring. So, what results were actually found when these two plants were crossed? They produced a total of 52 seeds in the following combinations. Let's compare this to the percentages we expected. As you can see, our plants produced offspring in almost the exact percentages that we would have expected. A little variation is almost always seen, but in general, the trends we calculated from our Punnett square were a very good prediction for what would actually happen. This suggests that just as Mendel stated, the traits are inherited independently of one another. As we went through the lesson today, we learned how to construct a Punnett square to predict the genotype and phenotype ratios of various cross combinations. We also used a Punnett square to determine if two traits were inherited independently. In the case we looked at, the pea plants gave us exactly the results we expected, but this won't always be the case with other traits and other organisms. Mendel got a lot right when it came to his laws of inheritance, but he also missed some important exceptions. We'll look at some non-Mendelian inheritance examples next time. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. See you next time.